Whether you need some fun PCBs for the holidays or something more serious, head over to the PCBWay website and click on the PCB instant quote. Then you can select various types of PCBs and your PCB specifications. You can then select if you want the stencil mask and even the assembly service. Then click calculate and simply place your order.
Hello YouTubers and welcome to this video where I'm going to give you an update on my high accuracy quartz clock project. Now before I get stuck into that, I just want to highlight that the Rigol scope, which I spoke about in my last video, which I recommended folks, if you were keen to have a scope with a 10 megahertz reference in, there was a good option to go and buy one of these. There is a challenge or an issue with that 10 megahertz input. There's a trick to actually ensuring that it's actually using it and being able to check it. And I'm gonna do a video specifically on that after this one. Right, so let me give you the update on my clock project because it has now taken another nice big step. I was previously working with this cheap Chinese clock. I was trying to inject a signal and trying to work out what frequency was the correct frequency to get this to run so that it kept accurate time. Now you saw all those challenges in the previous video. It was difficult for me to see what this was running at because it had a noisy signal coming out. It had noise on it, and more critically, it had jitter. Now, what I'm going to show you in the video right now is the reason I've gone and ditched this and gone to my plan B, was to actually use an Arduino and write my own code, my own clock code, which I've got on the bench. So in this video, let me explain what you're going to see. I had to handhold. I recorded this from my phone because, to tell you the truth, I couldn't find a way to actually save the file from the Rigol. But the Rigol has got the useful feature where you can record a signal, and I set this to record my pulse every 10 seconds or every 10 instances, which would have been every 10 seconds. So I recorded that over an extended period of time to see what was going to happen with the drift. And I could now rule out that the scope was going to be part of that issue, because obviously having a 10 megahertz input in the back of it, and I also double checked with two reference signals to make sure there was no error that was being incurred by the scope and that any drift I saw was actually by the circuit. And if you look at this video, you'll see I've got the blue trace on the trigger line, and it actually stays there for 7 hours. It sits on the trace. There's seemingly no drift at all. Then over a period of 50 minutes, it suddenly drifts 78 milliseconds and then stays put static for another 14 hours. Really odd behavior. I think I mentioned this in the previous video when I saw this on when I was using the RNS scope, and I was concerned that maybe there was an error being incurred by the RNS scope. It's all in this circuit somehow, somewhere maybe in the code at a certain time during the day, it suddenly runs at a different pace and then goes back to what it was running. I shouldn't say I wasn't going to bother. I'd love to know what the cause of that issue is, but it's potentially a difficult one to try and troubleshoot. So I've ditched this and I've now gone to my Arduino. So we're going to go to the bench. We might be getting into the weeds a little bit. There's some interesting challenges, even with the Arduino, which I'll explain when we get there. And again, this video might not be for those folks who kind of, this is, I say, a bit nuts and bolty, a bit niche. But if you are interested in Arduino and timekeeping, you might get some interest out of this. Okay, so let me just show you what I've got on the bench in a wide view, and then we'll come in closer so we can get a bit more detail. I've got an Arduino Uno on my bench, which runs at 16 megahertz. I've got a shield plugged onto it, which includes an LCD display and some push buttons. So really nice and handy, makes it easy to work with as a project. I'm injecting a 1 kilohertz signal into it as my clock pulse. And then I'm measuring the actual 1 second pulse output from the clock on the oscilloscope, on the Rigol. And I'm comparing that to a very accurate GPS signal. And that's how I've been able to measure the drift over just shy of a day. So let's come into the Arduino. Righty-ho. So what I've got, as noted, is an Arduino Uno under here. I have gone and soldered
an SMA connector with a piece of coax to do the clock pulse coming in. So that's a far better arrangement. It kind of helps with the integrity of the signal coming in. It goes in the board and is read by one of the digital inputs so that I can sample that clock pulse or count the clock pulse to get my clock running. I then also have, I've got an output pulse going through pin 13, which is the LED pin. So I'm looking at that with the red clip over there and the black clip down over here. I'm able to set the time on this with these push buttons. I actually have this time set wrong. I misset the hours, but the minutes and the seconds are spot on. And I can dictate, or I can choose the frequency that I want this clock to run on, because I've obviously written the code. So one could question, well, why on earth didn't I do this to start off with? And had I started off with this, I would have missed a lot of learning opportunities along the way. So I'm glad I've kind of banged my head with the other project, because a lot of interesting side learning has come out of that. But ultimately, this is the most sensible way to progress with this project. I was kind of thinking, should I set the clock pulse at 1 hertz? So as long as I've got a very accurate 1 hertz or 1 pulse per second coming in, it makes the chances of this running correctly a lot easier. Now, when I say that, let me qualify that. I know from experience with doing my epoch clock that there is a limit on how quickly certainly the Arduino Uno that runs at 16 megahertz can sample an incoming pulse. Even though you've got a crystal or a processor perhaps running at near 16 megahertz, it's got other hardware and processes happening which slow down the rate at which you can sample at. And then your code, depending on how well or how badly you write your code, will dictate how fast you can sample a clock pulse. Now, from previous experience with the epoch clock, and I did some testing on this, I know that the maximum sample rate that I can do with the code that I'm running is somewhere between 30 kilohertz and 32 kilohertz. I know this runs at 30 kilohertz without any problem, but as soon as I go to, I actually set it to 32.768, and then it couldn't sample the clock pulse properly. It wasn't running at all correctly. Now, the reason I'm not running this at 1 hertz, because that's what I thought. Keep it simple, have an accurate 1 pulse per second coming in, and then all I have to worry about is the accuracy of that pulse. At 1 pulse per second, it becomes very difficult to sync up with atomic time. If you've got an ovenized crystal running this and you start that up, you have to start it up and give it at least 15, 20, 30 minutes to warm up. It is then running. It has already got its pulse going at a certain rate. That rate is not going to be exactly what the atomic second is. So then how do you synchronize that up to atomic time? You could do some trickery by, let's say, putting a switch so that the output from your ovenized crystal, you have a switch where it's switched off. So the ovenized crystal warms up, but the pulse isn't coming out and downsampled, let's say, to 1 hertz, and you switch that. But that starts to complicate things, and you're modifying a circuit which could potentially incur other issues. So I decided on 1 kilohertz, 1,000 pulses per second. So that makes it very easy to sync up. I've got a lot of resolution to sync it up exactly to an atomic second. So hence I'm doing that. Although that brings me to another issue I've just banged my head against. I have an ovenized crystal coming in which runs at 10 megahertz. And it puts out it divides that down. It's got a frequency divider where you get 1 pulse per second, which I've noted I can't use now. But the next step up is 100 kilohertz, which is too fast for this. So what I'm potentially going to try and run this on so I can sample a little bit faster is an Arduino Duo. Why? This runs at 84 megahertz, as I remember correctly, so it will sample faster. Now, why aren't I using that right now? For one, I'd already set this up yesterday and I was testing overnight, so I didn't want to undo this. But when I was compiling the code to run on the Duo, It came up with an error because it's not 100% compatible with the Uno. In the code that I'm using a tone command to actually output the signal that I'm measuring across the LED pin 13. Now, the reason I'm using that tone command is that if I did a traditional, what you can do is I could tell one of the digital pins to go high, write a delay for a fraction of a second, and then go low, so that I'd get my one pulse per second coming out. But the mere fact of using the delay command would mean I would slow down the processing of this. Whereas the tone command doesn't do that. There's no delay. You say you just issue a tone command with a frequency and how long you want it to come out for, and then that comes out. But the GPU doesn't recognize, doesn't compile straight away with that. There's a fair bit of trickery to get to work with that. So I think I've got another plan to get an output pulse that I can measure without all the complications. So I say that's my next test. But right now, this is working very well. So let me show you how accurate this has been. As you can see, once I've shown you the Rigol and how accurate this is, I'm going to restart this so you can see the process of how I can set the time, and I'll talk a little bit about that. I also have a days counter on here, so that once I actually get this running with an ovenized crystal, I can easily keep track of how long it's been running for and then compare its accuracy. Right, so on the scope, if you look very carefully, you'll see the signal is actually updating once per second. The two signals I have here, the yellow trace is the actual pulse coming from the Arduino, and I'll come out and I'll show you that pulse and what it looks like, because there's some interesting bits and pieces there. And then the blue trace is the pulse from the GPS, that my GPS discipline oscillator, the one pulse per second, and that's what I'm referencing against. So I'm triggering off the yellow trace, and yesterday when I left this line over here was sitting exactly on the trigger line. I synced them up exactly, and then I wanted to see what the drift was. And over here, I've got, there's a slight difference because it's actually changed since this morning. It's increased a little bit. It was at 20, we're now at 21 microseconds. And I haven't, yeah, have I got that? Yeah, I have got on that on the trace. But that is the drift in 0.88 of a day. So not quite a full day. But I extrapolated this out. And if I was to maintain this same amount of drift in a 24-hour period, this clock would be accurate to within 1/100th of a second per year. So remember, my target is 3 seconds. I can afford to drift by 8 milliseconds. This is only drifted by 21 microseconds. So that now tells me, for one, I'm happy with what I'm measuring on the scope. The clock circuit is doing what it's supposed to do. It'll now come down to the clock source that I choose. So the ovenized crystal and the fact that it's got to use frequency division to divide the circuit down to a frequency that I can use, and hopefully it does that accurately enough. So that's going to be the next challenge. But here, definitely this circuit is now working nicely. So let me just change the scale and show you what the actual signal looks like, because that'll be fairly interesting. That is the signal that is coming out from the pin 13 that would drive the LED. And as you can see, there's a fair bit of high frequency. I'm not going to call it noise. That is the pulse width modulation that is supposed to come out of that. And if I remember correctly, that is at 490 hertz is what that is over there. So even though there is noise, what I'm able to do with the oscilloscope, because I'm not trying to trigger off with a frequency counter, I'm able to add some delay in the triggering. So if I pull up the menu and I go to the settings, I've got some hold off. I've got just shy of 1 second. So I delay the trigger so that it doesn't get caught up in any of this. It delays so that I can trigger off the edge over there each second.
Right, so let me just show you the operation, the basic, quick basic operation of the clock. I will eventually release the code that I'm using, and most of it is actually my code. But previously, I've often grabbed a lot of code and kind of hacked code. This, I just looked at the sample code to make this shield work. I took that out and I wrote my own code for the clock, the days and the setting procedure. What I plan to do is, in fact, add perhaps a date at the bottom here once I get this finally running, and then have the ability for this to cater for daylight savings. Because if I do want to run this for a year or several years without even touching or changing the time, I do not want to have to manually go in here and change the hours when daylight savings happen. So that is something I'm going to try and build into this as well. What I'm going to do right now, I'm going to power it off so that it restarts. So power off, power back on, it'll then come up here. So what the code does, it comes up and asks you to set the time. And this probably seems like a very simple clock, and it's probably a really simple bit of code to do this. But for those of you who perhaps haven't written code before for Arduino, even something like this can get a little bit challenging, particularly if you're trying to write the code as efficiently as possible so it doesn't cause any delays to mess up your sampling time when you're trying to sample the pulse coming in. So for instance, getting a clock to work where you've got your leading zero. So let's say your seconds are less than 9 seconds. If you didn't write a clever bit of code to cater for a leading zero, then your seconds would start here, there'd be no leading zero, and then it would like jump out and it would change the formatting. So there's a bit of coding here to allow you to have leading zeros until your digits go 10 or above for both the seconds, the minutes and the hours. I then also have to at this point capture and set the time. So I've got the setup for two keys that I can push. I've got it set for the left and right cursor keys. So doing that, I've got a delay on here so that if I push it down, I can flick through and set the time quickly. Or if I just click the button quickly, I can then go and set the time that way. On the right-hand cursor, I can go and set the minutes. And again, I can hold that down and spin through the minutes. It doesn't change up the hours. I've wanted it so that I just set the minutes on the one and the hours on the other. You'll see it just cycles through. So did that jump up? So you can see I could perhaps add a bit more of a delay because sometimes it changes too quickly. But anyway, that's the fun of writing your own code, because I can modify this to work the way I want it to. And then what I have it set to, as soon as I hit the select, it will then start the timekeeping. So I keep the seconds at 0, 0, and as soon as I hit select, bang, it then starts the clock and it starts going. And again, I can play around with this code. I've thought of even having an option where I could actually select the input frequency. So if I wanted to play with, let's say I wanted to play with working at 1 hertz or 1 kilohertz, or I need to try and get this up to 100 kilohertz. Because that'll be the clock pulse that I'm getting from the reference that I've got coming in, that I can actually have that as a selection choice at startup. I can go and select the frequency. I could even do digital trimming or calibration of this. I can select the number of clock pulses to use, and this goes back to the epoch clock. I could, if I want to have if I wanted to introduce a calibration, I could have a button that you could push, let's say once a year. Let's say you saw this drifting by 5 seconds because there was some aging on the ovenized crystal. I could have a button that you push. It then receives a reference, let's say from a satellite, it gets a reference time. It then compares the amount of time that's passed from when you last set to the latest set. It says, right, I've counted so many seconds, but in actuality, this number of seconds has passed. I am incorrect by this amount. I can divide the error over that time and then change and add a calibration factor to cater for, let's say, if there's any aging on the ovenized crystal. That's what I did in the epoch clock. And I could introduce this into that as well. But anyway, I've got the good bones now to work from. Let me just quickly show you an ovenized crystal. Okay, I'm not going to spend too much time on this because I'm going to go through this in the video, perhaps when I talk about the Rigol in the next video I post. But I received an ovenized crystal. It's a 10 megahertz crystal. It has a pot in there. You've got two outputs. One of them is fixed at 10 megahertz. The other one you can set a jumper and factor it up. I forget what the factors are, but you can increase the clock pulse that comes out of that. It's not completely adjustable. I say you have to go by certain factors. I have it in this little plastic box, and this will be part of the education, is that even though you've got an ovenized crystal, so it's got a little heater in there to try and keep the crystal going at a consistent pace, if I just had this open on my bench, and even in fact, and I'll just open this, even having it in here, if I just place my hand on this box for a couple of seconds, it'll start the clock, it'll change the output frequency of the clock. Only to a small degree, but enough that would it incur error, which would be too much for me. If you have something like this open on your bench, and you merely walk past or you waft your hand on it, it can throw it out by a large amount. And I'm going to show you that in the next video when I show you a frequency counter, my Fluke frequency counter, which has an ovenized clock, and the challenges with trying to keep a time base ticking accurately. It's not that easy, and you realize again that the value of having a reference signal from a GPS on your bench, because trying to keep clocks accurate inside your test equipment is not that easy. But I'll show that in the next video.
Righty-ho, so there you go. I say, a much better base to work from now that I've got that Arduino clock running. It gives me far better options in being able to write the code and make changes myself. The next challenge, as I said, will be the time bases that I test. I've got an interesting frequency counter on the way. It has a feature that I was talking about, which I didn't know actually existed. It's a discontinued frequency counter, and I'll show you that because I'm going to have several time bases. I've got a temperature compensated oscillator, the ovenized one, and I'm going to be testing these over time. So having a few frequency counters running at the same time, where you're actually comparing time bases under the same conditions, is really handy. And we're going to see what various time bases can do in terms of their accuracy, their stability, particularly over time, and seeing how a little bit of a temperature fluctuation or what have you can affect their operation. I will post the next video soon showing the challenges with that 10 megahertz input and things you need to be aware of to be able to get it actually functioning. And I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.